Hello, everyone.
Happy
Hey,
New
Frederick.
Year.
Happy to have you back here, and thanks for joining again our webinar. Today we do have a bit of a different viewing angle because we had some technical issues with our camera, but I think you won't mind to have a little change here. I have Kevin here in the background to help me with all the techniques, and I have Frederick as usual in Hong Kong, and he looks fresh like ever. Yeah. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you very much. Yeah, we're excited about this 4800, and there's more coming. So yeah, let's go ahead with it.
Yeah, let's do that. As you can see here on the first slide, it's not only about the 4800, but I also added the 28 and the 38. All the information, all the features we have in the lower models, of course, do also count for the top model, for the 4800. And I just want to do a brief recap on these features. So you will get a little refresh of what you heard already. In addition to that, I also added some information we didn't share so far, which is coming via a firmware update somewhere in March, end of March, where we're going to add certain functionality to the receiver and a new way of setting up speakers. So that's also part of the first section of this presentation. And in the second part of the presentation, I'm going deeper into the 4800, so you know all about it and what makes it so special. So let's quickly jump into the presentation here. So of course, I will have to change this one here. So the presentation mode does work now. First of all, you can see again the lineup. And as you know, 28, 3800 we already introduced, 48 is on the list today, and in 2 weeks from now you will get the ABC A1H, and I hope to see you there again for our webinar, because that's then our real flagship. We'll really go into the deep technical stuff. So as you can see, 28, 38 and 48, they're all different in the cosmetic and the design, and especially the 4800 now is coming with these nice trap doors, so it's much more advanced design. It has metal front, and the overall appearance is quite upmarket, I would call it. And behind the trap door, you can see all the hidden control keys, so it's very clean design and very nicely to use and to look at. Inside, a very brief one here, top or lower right corner, you see the 2800. Left corner, the 3800, we already can see, especially on the heat sinks, where the amplifier modules, amplifiers are installed on. There's quite a difference here. And the 4800 is, topping it as well, because we are going to change here the layout of the amplifier stage from standard to monolithic one. But I will come to this one back later. Just a refresh on the improvements we did for the 2000, 3000, 4800 products in general. So we increased HDMI connectivity, so at least three, if not all, inputs are now 8K capable. We have the new HD GUI, and of course we also have new DSP chipset for the 38 and 4800, which gives us more functionality in the audio processing, but also in the room calibration, for example. Then we are going to have four subwoofer outputs on the top model 3848. Audio improvements as usual. As explained, we always tweak the new products coming to market to at least achieve the same performance as the former model. But of course, our aim is always to go one step further and even make it better. Well, so that's what we are doing by component change, selecting the right parts and the right spot in the product to really push the quality level all the time. New technology, as mentioned, we have the new DSP, which also gives us the possibility now for Dirac and MPEG-H, 360 reality audio, Aural 3D. So this counts then for the 3800 and the 4800. As you can see it here on this screen, right-hand side, 1700, 2800, the seven channel models, 38 and 4800. Are the nine channel models doing 11.4 processing and having all these additional features in comparison to the lower models. Very important to know is that the 4800 is actually the product which is now made in our own factory in Shirakawa, means made in Japan. So this gives us more flexibility and even possibility to put even higher quality components or higher quality circuit designs into the product, like the monolithic amplifier modules. Let's have a quick look to the rear products, the HDMI connectivity. As you can see, the higher you go in the lineup, the more connectivity you get and the more 8K connectivity you will have. On the two upper models, you also have the Nessone 2 video capability via HDMI. Remote handset, also already briefly talked about, we added the nice button HDMI output selection, so that if you have a TV screen and a projector connected, you can easily toggle between these outputs. So that's very handy, and you don't have to use the option menu or go via the setup. I think I didn't talk about this one yet. So for all the HDMI outputs, we are now supporting 300 milliampere of current. This is normally used to drive active HDMI cables. So you don't need any external power supply anymore, but the booster in the HDMI cable can be fed by the HDMI output of the receiver. So that's very handy. Less wire, less power supply is needed. And this counts for all the outputs there. HDMI diagnostic, we also did modification on that one. I explained we put some default settings in it, so it's easier to identify if there's an issue in your video connectivity or audio connectivity via HDMI. We have a built-in tool, the HDMI diagnostic, which helps you to identify where a problem is coming from. And then you can do some counter measurements, either by swapping a cable or using a limiting mode to just reduce the load to the cable. Another nice feature or improvement is that we now have the possibility to select the video standard by or per source selected. So we can do 4K, 4K enhanced, or either 8K enhanced. So by that, we can do a nice mix of legacy devices, but also with combined with new 8K enhanced devices. That was not possible before because it was either all or nothing. A nice feature, which we for sure didn't talk about yet, is because it will only come in March 23 with the firmware update, is that we can have ARC off even when HDMI control is set to on. So this was also not possible yet. Gives you, again, more flexibility when setting up the system. You have, you will be more independent, let's say, in this respect. So this will come by end of March. Then quickly, evolution of the graphic user interface. As mentioned, we have the new HD GUI. It's now 1080p resolution. And I just put up some of the old graphics, how the graphic user interface looked like back in the past. So top left, I would say it's nearly 20 years ago. We all have been very excited when we saw that we have something on screen to set up our speakers. And it was very simple. And if you look how it evolves over the time and to the final new HD GUI here, I think it's very nice to see what kind of steps we have done here. And then another nice feature coming in March is quick select. You know, we have quick select on other products. And nowadays it is that you have to do all your settings on your AVR, press and hold the quick select button, and it will store all the information set at that moment. We are now going to do some changes here, because we can now identify or define which settings actually should be stored. Yeah, you can enable and disable. You can say, okay, master volume, for example, I don't want to store the value. Yeah, so I did all my setting, press the quick select button, and I had the volume set to 50. It will always come back to 50. But actually, I don't want that. I only want to have all the other settings, but not the volume. So I can disable that one. Keep all the other settings, but volume will be just the last volume selected. So that's very handy, gives a lot more flexibility. We can rename the quick select, so we really can customize now these. Coming in March, a very nice one. manual speaker setup. I also said we are going to do some changes on the speaker setup, also a March update. So nowadays you have actually, let's say, three screens where you have to select, first of all, what is my amp configuration? Then I have a screen where I select what kind of speakers I have in my system. Is a center or a surround back or height speakers? What is actually connected? And I can decide, is it a speaker or is it speaker and pre-out or only pre-out? And this now we are going to bring together on one screen, which makes the manual setup much easier, much fluent. Yeah, so you don't have to flip through different screen. It's all combined on one screen. So very nice, very handy. And another one new coming also in March is the base management. So we also here, we are going to support the customer with more information, with graphic information of what's actually going on, how the base redirection is going to happen if he selects certain settings in the receiver. I will dig into this one in 2 weeks from now when I'm going to do the ABC A1H training, because then we have more time to also have a closer look to this one here. But as said, very nice feature. Our engineering team in Japan did a great job here together with our UX team, the user experience team, to have a better solution, easier to set up a way if you are, let's say, the not the novice guy who was using our setup assistant, but the more specialist guy who really wants to go into all the details. So quick summary here again, it's, let's say, a general feature for 2022, sound improvement, HDMI connectivity, HDMI diagnostic, new HD graphic user interface, improved user experience with all the things I just mentioned. We have advanced the AI mode. I didn't touch on that one yet. Quick select, new speaker setup, base management, and the FSC certified packaging. So also doing a bit for the environment here. So let's have a look now to the 3800 and 4800 common feature set. Of course, it starts with the DSP. As said, we have a new Graphinlight XP, Shark DSP now working in these receivers. And these do give us additional capability. Yeah, not only DTS, Dolby Atmos, IMAX Enhance, but also Aura 3D, which is new for the 3800. But we also have now MPEG-H on board. We can do 360 reality audio. And we have direct room calibration capability coming by a firmware update also in March. And we have four subwoofer outputs, count for both of these units, or let's say for all the units above the 3800, including 3800 and above. Extended Aura 3D configuration. As you can see, now we also do support the center height and also the top surround channel. So I marked this with a red rectangle over here so that you actually can run six height speakers with Aura 3D. So that's a nice one. And in March, as well, with the update, we are going to do the extension of the configuration possibilities for the Aura 3D setup, because we will also allow then to use a Dolby Atmos speaker setup. So with having six in-ceiling speakers, we do allow to use these speakers for Aura 3D. So it can be all done with one configuration. So we found some a nice, let's say, algorithm to get the best performance also from the Dolby Atmos speakers with Aura 3D. So it's easier to run and install a system. Then we do have the advanced 7.4.4 setup for both models. As said, they do have nine channels amplified built in, and you can of course extend the system to an 11 channel system by utilizing the pre-outs. And the pre-outs, as you can see here, so having five floor or let's say seven floor speakers, so five channel plus surround back, we can add the pre-outs, for example, to add it to the front, or we can use the pre-outs also for surround back or for height speakers. So this gives us the flexibility to build up a nice 7.4.4 system. So it means actually 11.4 channel processing power with both of these units just adding another stereo amplifier, and we can configure which signal should be used for the additional amplifier. Then we talked about the preamplifier mode, which actually is also improving the quality of the audio signal on the pre-outs of the product. So we can change between speaker and pre-out or just pre-out. And if we select just pre-out, the quality we can reach out of the pre-out channels or pre-out connectors is increased, having less distortion. It's a cleaner signal, and it's easier to drive than external power amplifiers. For subwoofers, we talked about already on the former trainings of the 3800. That also counts for the 4800. We have the opportunity now to connect up to four subwoofers. And you can also, I'm just going to mention it here now because I don't have an extra slide for it. You can also connect the butt kicker to it, so a tactile transducer actually to check your sofa, if you like. For the if in the case of using two, three, or even four subwoofers, we also have the option to do a new mode, which is the directional mode. So for the subwoofer, as you can see, we have the standard mode and the directional mode. If we do a directional mode, we actually can assign which signal of the other speakers in the room are sent to the subwoofers as well for a better integration. So in the maximum configuration, like you can see it on the right-hand side with four subwoofers, you can define a zone for the front left subwoofer, front right subwoofer, rear left, rear right, and you can assign which speaker signal of the surrounding speakers in this area will be sent also to the subwoofer for a nice integration. So that's a pretty cool feature, and it's working really, really nicely. Then, of course, we have also the support of these four subwoofers in our Audacy app. I just want to highlight again our Audacy app here. That's really something for the guys who want to go a bit more deeper under the hood and do all the settings more fine-tuned and more to their like. I really want to promote our Audacy app because it's a very powerful tool for just 20 euro. Audacy Direct Live, so I said we are going to add now the Direct Live capability. However, Audacy will stay our number one room calibration system. It will come with the product free of charge, very easy to use because it's integrated in our setup system. For the, let's say, professional use, we are also going to add the Direct Live capability that will come with the same update by March, so end of March. So we will have this Direct Live capability. To use Direct Live in the product itself, you will have to purchase, of course, a license from the Direct website, and that's a licensing scheme they are offering. So we are now going to phase one. That means we are offering the room correction of Direct Live, which means that's the blue area marked here. You can get a license for limited bandwidth, so you do adjustment for 20 up to 500 hertz, or you can go full bandwidth and it goes even up to 20 kilohertz. In the phase two, we are going to offer as well on our units the bass control function. And here you can see as well there are different packages available where the customer can select from. But this will be phase two, that we do the bass control specific Dirac correction, and that will be in 2024, so next year. Here again, the summary. So the left-hand side I already mentioned. For the right-hand side, this is now what's coming on top. For the 38 and the 4800, we have the more powerful Shark DSP, the Griffin Light XP, with 11-channel processing, which gives us Aura 3D newly on the 38 and 360 reality audio on both units as a new feature. So that means also, of course, MPEG-H. We have the four subwoofer outputs with the standard and directional mode, tactile transducer. I mentioned we have the advanced preamplifier mode, which gives us better audio quality if we are just running the pre-outs of the unit, if you're just running it as a full preamplifier or just a specific channel or two or five via the pre-auth, then we have a better performance option here. And we are going to bring Direct Live as an update in spring 2023, so means March. So then let's have a closer look to the X4800, because now we are really going into the area where we really can drive really big home cinemas, because the unit is much more powerful. It's the whole construction is completely different to the 3800. And actually, I just want to focus not on the standard features, which we already covered in the former slides, but now I'm going to focus on the rectangle part. So I already mentioned at the beginning, the unit is made in Chiricahua. So it's our own factory, as you can see on the little picture on the right-hand side. That's a denim factory where all our high-class premium products are made. So it's really made in Japan. The 4800 was always one of our key models to really show off, to strengthen our position in the AV segment and to really highlight what we are capable of doing, but still on a affordable price tag, so it's not going crazily expensive. What we added here now is the monolithic amplifier module construction. So this is now tripping down from the 6700 AVR, because this technology we already use over years now. It started with the premium class and then it stripped it down 8500, 6700, and now it's also down in the 4800. But that's only possible because we moved the production to our own factory, to Chiricahua. Don't expect next year or the year after that you will get it in the successor of a 3800. That's just not realistic. Yeah. So with this machine, we are going to maintain our position as a technology leader in the AV segment. And actually, yeah, we are market leader in AV anyhow. So this is a clear statement. That's our position where we want to be. And that's what we are working on to keep. Looking to the performance level, I already mentioned briefly at the beginning, the construction, internal construction of these units is quite different. If you go from, let's say, 2800, which is 7-channel, you can see the chassis size increases. If you go 3800, 4800, they are bigger, but also the construction of the amplifier section is completely different. The size of the transformer is going to increase the higher you go up in the lineup. So 4800, 6700, they both have these monolithic amplifier module construction. And that's how it looks if you tear it apart. On the left-hand side, you can see the power stage of the former 4700. That's actually built with two heat sinks and two PCBs placed vertical, where you have either 5 or 4 channels on to come to a total of 9 channel of amplification. For the new 4800, you can see now we have one heatsink and then 9 individual power amplifier modules from left to right. 9, I marked it over there. So this really gives us a real, let's say, nice separation of this channel. It's a better channel separation, cleaner amplification of the audio signal. So here's the power coming from, here's the clarity coming from. We are going to hear from the 4800. But also, before I go into push all the audio signals towards the power stage, of course, we have all the digital audio processing in the product. And that's very important, as you know well. So I just made a graphic over here where you can see how actually the signal flow is. The slight blue grayish area is where all the digital audio is going on, and the greenish area is for the analog part. So focusing on the digital audio, of course, in the center, you can see the DSP, which is the Griffin Light XP DSP, which is so powerful that it handles all the audio formats. But also for this unit now, the 4800, we have the Denon AL32 multi-channel processing, which refines the digital audio signal. We have the signal routing, we have the speaker configuration, level distance base management. That's all going on in the digital domain before the audio signal gets passed on to the DA converter. Let's have a brief look to AL32 processing. You know, it's a technology owned by Denon, developed by Denon. And actually, it was designed or developed for CD playback to improve the CD audio quality, because on the digital process, you are losing some information by the digitization. And with doing the AS32 processing, we're increasing the bit numbers from 16 to 32, which helps us to refine the audio signal, the digital audio information, which will be sent to the DA converter. And we do get out of the DA converter a more refined analog audio signal. Now, this is the DSP again, which I just explained. And we do have, for the whole construction of this digital area in the 4800, as well as the upper models, we have the so-called DDSC HD32, which means it's a dynamic discrete surround circuit. So all the different stages you can see in the audio processing are discrete. So it's not combined chipsets. No, it's all made in discrete. By that, we can select the best components to fit together to get the best performance in the end. And all the processing is done, as said before, in 32-bit. So just to highlight or to show you again how different there's a configuration is and the bit quality is. So on the left-hand side, it's about the digital audio board, what I'm talking about now. Yeah, on the left-hand side, you see for the entry model, everything is put on one PCB. Yeah, it's of course more cost efficient, just have one PCB. However, you're very much limited in space and the components you can use, and what kind, how wide your signal lines are, your supply lines for the power, and so on. You're very limited. In the mid-range, we're already separating a digital and analog side, so you get an additional audio PCB to it. And if you go to, and if you now go to the 4800, we even bring it further. So we have a purely digital board, and then the DA converter will be added to the analog audio board, so that you really have a very close connection to all the analog audio processing and further treatment. So by that, we really get a nice separation again between the different blocks. We get more space. We can use better part, bigger parts, and so on and so on. So that all helps to improve the audio quality. We have nice design for the DA conversion. Also here, it's very important to have the best components built in. And we also use dedicated components, customized components, fitting really to our needs and to our wanted sound quality. So also here we put a lot of attention to really get the best digital signal converted to the analog signal to the best quality. And then once you have the analog signal, of course, you're passing it on to the preamplifier stage for further processing, volume control, etc. pp. And then you bring it on to the power amplifier, where you do have then, of course, or you are in the need of having a good power amplification with the monolithic amplifier board I mentioned before. And you, of course, to feed everything, you need a strong power supply and high quality main capacitors, block capacitors, where actually the energy is coming out if you start to drive your speakers with impulses, heavy bass attacks, and so on. Overall, again, it's about how do I get the best performance from my digital input signal or even analog input signal to my speakers. And the best performance, of course, you can achieve if you do as less harm to the original audio signal than possible. So the best performance you always get if your product itself acts like an wire and just pass it on the signal uniterated, and just increase the level to really drive your speakers. By that, we have then achieved our goal to get the Denon sound characteristic. And I just want to bring it up here again, vivid and spacious. That's what our sound engineer for Denon, Yamauchi-san, is always working on to get it right. So vivid means we want to have it lively and crispy. So it should have a nice sparkling in the sound. You really should get all the details pinpoint somewhere in the sound field, which you create by your speaker setup being a 7.1, 7.4, 7.4.6, whatever you like, or in this case a 7.4.4, because we have the 11.4 channel processing. So all these nice details should be lively and crisp displayed in the sound field and should be direct and powerful. It should be really touching you. You should feel the energy coming from your speakers, which are driven by the powerful X4800. And the sound itself should be spacious. So it means that the sound is not just coming out of your speakers, but actually it's filling the room by positioning the sound all over the space and not just at the speaker front. So that by that, we like to involve the speaker, the listener into the scene. All right, that was a very quick one now here. That will give us more time for questions and answers. And here's a nice picture again of the unit, because beside the black one, which you can see in my back here, we also have, of course, the premium silver version. So, Rederik, it's up to you now.
Yes. Hi, Oliver. Thank you for the very nice presentation. There's a couple questions coming in, and I hope this, I put it in the chat. If you guys want to ask questions, use the questions tab, which is on the right side of your toolbar. The first one that I would like to address is about the HDMI diagnostics. Which of our AVRs have it? And are we planning to bring this to all AVRs, or is it already available to all AVRs? Could you elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah, it is already available on all AVRs. So it's not just limited to the flagships, but it's all over the old lineup. We are offering this HDMI diagnostic for the guys which do have access to D-Media, which is our platform where you can find service manuals and user manuals. There you can also find an user manual for the HDMI diagnostic. Check it out, just type in diagnostic and you will see in the search result HDMI diagnostic, and you can pick from different years because it's also changing a bit what kind of button combination you have to press to activate HDMI diagnostic.
Okay, next question. Could you explain a little bit how that butt kicker works? It's sending out a signal. It's not from a track or so. How does it exactly work in terms of triggering the butt kicker?
Mm-hmm. So it will get information from the LFE signal. And I think even if you have your speaker set to small, you know, then a certain portion of the signal will be sent to the subwoofer. And also this information will be sent to the butt kicker because actually the subwoofer outputs, we have four as said, one will be assigned then the subwoofer number four output will be assigned to drive the butt kicker. And actually it will get the same signal like the other subwoofer outputs, but you can do additional settings for the output level, and you can also limit again the frequency so that you really can fine adjust the butt kicker to work properly with the whole scene.
And you can even trigger a whole bunch of them if you cascade them with the same signal, I believe.
Yeah, exactly.
A common question that comes back every single time: when are we going to be able to use wireless surrounds like the Denon Home 150, 250, 50s?
Right, yeah. So if you want to do that, we will have to implement two of the LEGO modules, the HEOS chips. LEGO is the internal name for it, the HEOS modules, but that's no plan for now.
Okay. Is there any plan for an Oliver special dive into HDMI diagnostics, a special individual session for this on how to use it? I think this is a very technical webinar training.
It will be very special, very technical, but for sure we can think about it, no problem.
Awesome. With one HDMI out button, we no longer have to use a quick select options to switch between monitors and projectors. Will this eventually also trickle down to smaller units?
The HDMI out button is also on the smaller units. As soon as you have two outputs, the remote will also have the HDMI out button. So if you take the X2800, you will also have the button on the remote.
Will Odyssey and Dirac combinations or calibrations work together? I think we can elaborate that both options will be available using the speaker setup. How does it work exactly?
You know, we do have the option to do some two speaker presets. Yeah, so let's say we introduced this feature, I think, 2 years ago. And the option we have is we can do one calibration of the speakers, let's say for daytime watching. So you have your blinds open and you're watching on your TV screen. You have your speaker set up, calibrated, and stored to preset one. At nighttime, you're lowering your screen, you're using your projector, blinds are closed, so you have a different acoustic in your room. You have a new calibration of your speakers, you start to preset two. What we now can do with Odyssey and Dirac is that we can, for example, do an Odyssey calibration, store it on preset one, and do a Dirac calibration and store it on preset two, if you like. And Dirac itself then has additional options for four different calibrations which you can store.
And speaking of Dirac, there's two common questions here as well about, as Dirac just announced at CES, they will have the bass correction, the bass system, and also the ART, the acoustic treatment, room treatment. Is that going to be available for us as well at some stage?
Yeah, it's the active room treatment, actually. That's something we also are looking into. So as said, we are going to have the bass control somewhere in 2024. Maybe we are already able to add ART at that time as well, but it's nothing written in stone yet.
Yeah, yep. It's a nice prospect knowing that at one point it will be available. So next question. Can you use spare channels in the AVR to power the butt kicker as they are 4 ohms? I'm not sure if that's making any difference whether it's 8 or 4, right?
No, that doesn't make any difference. It's not going to work like this, because then what kind of signal are you going to give to the butt kicker to get a proper signal if you connect it to the speaker output? You might want to use the front channel signal, left and right. And if you do a speaker AB setup and running AB in parallel, that might work. Yeah, but I'm not sure if it really will give you a good performance. So I really would recommend to use the pre-out, subwoofer 4 pre-out to drive the butt kicker.
Because there it's easier to set also the low pass filter and the frequency range and stuff.
Exactly.
To make it more powerful, the sensitivity. Yeah. Somebody's asking, when are we going to, what's the deal with Qobuz? When are we going to be able to use Qobuz?
It's a good question. It's on the list already for quite a while, like some other features as well. I don't have a final date for that, but it's not off the list, that I can confirm.
Capability of multi-zone segregation and playing a specific source in a specific zone. Do we have this capability?
Yeah, so if you want to, let's say you pick zone 2, you can select as audio signal, you can select source, which means it will play the same signal like it's in the main room, or you can select any specific input available. Yeah, you can set it to CD, you can set it to network, CBL, SAT, whatsoever.
Next question, are you able to elaborate a bit on the monolithic amp module that you spoke about?
Mm-hmm. So if you look to, I call it now a standard AV receiver, you have one PCB board where all components are built on for, let's say, 7 channels, for example. Yeah. They are sitting side by side, all on the same same board. So, and also, yeah, it's relatively easy to get some cross torque vibration from one channel to the other channel is moving very easily because it's all on one PCB, on one board. For the monolithic board, actually this, monolithic already, it's in the name, it's a mono amplifier. Each board is an amplifier on its own. And they will only get connected via one connection board, which is feeding the input signal, the power line, and then the output signal will run through the board as well. But the channels are much better separated. And you get much more space actually to build the amplifier because you have this specific board. Yeah, you can use higher quality components, better coils, better resistors or capacitor, larger capacitors and so on.
Okay, we have a question from Australia. Are we going to do a CI session? And I think I can answer yes. We're planning to do this before Q2. We should have a dedicated custom installation session. So stay tuned for that. We'll give you more information when that comes.
Could be also something where HDMI diagnostic can work or can be fitted in as well, because it's really a CI feature in this respect.
We'll take note of that. Can you listen to a Dolby Atmos music from Apple Music without a external player? How would you do that?
No, you will need an external player to feed
like
the
Apple
Dolby
TV,
Atmos.
Yes, yep. We use an Apple TV for that. How to use MBEC H decoding? What would be the source?
Let's say MBEC H decoding. At the moment, it's used with 360 reality audio, and to enjoy that, you will have, or to stream it, you will need to have a Chromecast, for example, connected via HDMI. Then you can feed the MBEC H signal into the receiver. Yeah, we don't have any broadcasting yet in Europe to use that functionality of MPEG-H.
I understood from our Japan engineers team that there is a possibility to demo the 360 if you're using a Sony TV that has the native Sony app to do broadcast, but you would need to use indeed a Chromecast Ultra. The standard Chromecast won't work, so it's an Ultra version.
Correct.
And then you should be able to, through the HDMI with the Chromecast, it will pass through the MBEC-H and the 360 signal to the AVR receiver to decode it. That's one way of doing it. Can we play on three HDMI output booths, input or separate? Can we play on the three HDMI outputs, both input or separate? I'm not quite sure what's meant here.
Yeah, most likely it's about if we can use the same signal. So let's separate a bit. So HDMI 1 and HDMI 2 output. Yeah, you can use dual, so means they both get the same signal, or you can just say, okay, HDMI 1 or HDMI 2. So that means actually if you select, let's say, Blu-ray as your source, you can watch it in parallel on HDMI 1 and 2. What you have to keep in mind is that the video output signal will follow the TV screen with the lowest resolution. So it will have to, in case both screens are the same, it's no problem. If you have one screen which has a lower resolution, it will define the output signal for both outputs. What you can do in addition is that you have the third HDMI output is the zone output. And of course, you can also say, okay, I would like to have my Blu-ray signal also on the zone output. But here you're running the risk that it will not be perfectly in sync with HDMI 1 and 2 out, because routing is slightly different. Maybe you want to add here while we just talk about it. What we have as an option is that you can assign. So that's also something more into CI business for in-shop installations, bars, whatsoever, that you can assign to different inputs the same video signal. Yeah, so that you have the same video signal. However, you can have for the different inputs, different audio inputs. So by that, you can always show the same video screen, but have different audio streams, or also the other way around. Yeah, you have different video outputs, but always have the same audio signal. So that's for, let's say, sports bars, quite an interesting feature. And just to mention.
Exactly. I was going to say sports bar or party mode kind of situation.
Right.
Okay. Could you ask Oliver if DTS X Pro is built in, or will it be made available through a firmware update for the 4800?
No, it's not possible for the 4800 because it's 11.4 channel processing. You will need at least 13.4. So for the upper models, like the X6700 and up.
The Odyssey Multi EQ app, can I do two presets for front A and B in the newer ones, or is it limited in the app? I had a customer attempt this and it didn't work. Odyssey Pro X, one calibration in setup A and then another calibration in setup B. It should work.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Because you can also select, if you do the calibration in the app, where it should be stored to. Yeah, you also select here speaker or preset one or preset two. You have done both calibrations, you can just push it over.
Okay, so maybe it's a user procedure where maybe the last step of storing it in that particular location wasn't successful. Okay, let's have a look. Are all the Dirac speaker settings selectable via discrete infrared, RS-232 or IP commands for custom install?
Oh, good question. Can't answer. Sorry.
This will
we'll have to look it up. Yeah, we do have a wide range of commands. And I would guess it will be possible, but I'm not 100% sure.
Yes, so we keep that question. It will be addressed in the dedicated Dirac session. Okay, next question from Jill is, can you switch between standard and directional subwoofer mode to compare without rerunning Odyssey?
You can change it manually, but I'm not sure how it's stored in Odyssey. So, of course, you do your calibration for the speakers. You have all the sizes. That's all fine. Yeah, so that's going to work, yeah? Because all the, let's say, parameters are set, and then you can just redirect the bass signal. Yep.
Right. Speaker setup one with and speaker setup two without. That's possible too, I guess.
Yeah, that's also possible.
Is there any talk of potential audio return channel from Z2 HDMI? What is Z2 HDMI? Zone 2 HDMI. There you go. ARC from Zone 2 HDMI.
No, I don't see that coming. Yeah, and you will also get quite a delay. So because then you have to process the audio signal in the AVR and send it back again to the second room or second zone. No, I don't see that.
That's going to be a lip sync issue, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Feature request for HEOS. One more. Will HEOS be supporting YouTube Music now that they have launched it?
I don't see it at the moment now.
Okay, I think we're almost through. Let me double check one more time. Oh yes, you had audio precision measurements that you did for the AV10 for Marantz. Do we have similar measurements for the 4800 that we can share?
Not for the 4800, but I will show you some in 2 weeks' time for the AVCA1H.
Okay. One more note from Marcus. Coming back, someone mentioning some butt kickers that use speaker cable. Would it be possible to use internal amplifiers to drive subwoofers? I know this is not ideal from a power and heat perspective in bigger systems, but with some small custom install setups, maybe it's possible and it would be quite convenient.
Yeah, in this case, I would really recommend if you're going to use a passive subwoofer, to add an external amplifier. I wouldn't bother the AVR receiver with driving the subwoofer.
So I think we're through all the questions. Thanks everyone for contributing. This was a nice session again, as usual. So I'm gonna hand it back to Oliver to do the closing.
Yeah, so we are spot on. Very happy that we managed perfectly in time. I really appreciate all your questions coming. this keeps this webinar lively and active, and I think very fruitful for all the audience. I hope to see you in 2 weeks' time. Yeah, and then we really go into the heavy stuff, the very nice ABC A1H, and I can really promise you it's a fantastic unit. Already here with the 4800, I'm sure you will be very, very happy. So thanks again for your time. Thanks, Frederick. Thanks, Gavin, for helping me out with the webinar here. And see you. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Bye.